teaching and traveling and working. On weekends, so I would make a house and work, my ministry, but then because I worked for the U.S. bishops, I was traveling to their diocese and doing some talk. Last week, I did a talk for some friends in California, and I did it from the upstairs of my house. And from Baltimore, and I did the same thing for my friends in Phoenix. And that's been a great blessing for me, to be home in the upstairs of my house, you know, wearing a nice pair of earrings and a nice top, and from the waist down, wearing old pants and my slippers. Right? And I'm home with my family, and home with my husband. And we've been safe and healthy, thanks be to God. But I know that even though many of us have blessings during the pandemic, we've also had some loss. We've lost loved ones. And not just those to COVID, but loved ones who passed away that had funerals where only 10 people could come. This has been very hard for us in Ireland, because our funerals take place over 3 days. What's the difference between an Irish wedding and an Irish wake? One less person at the Irish wake. Pretty much the same as to do, right? And I think this uncertainty is a thief. And it's a thief of your peace of mind. And it steals away. So all of us have believed actually during this pandemic. Do you want to know the day I cried during the pandemic? I'm pretty tough, like my husband would say, she's as tough as old boots. I'm a tough Irish woman. But, and like I say, I am so lucky to be home with my husband and our children. But I can't get home to see my family. I cannot get into Ireland. I cannot book a flight into Ireland to wear a hat. And so my dad, who's a widower, something happens and I can't get there. The day I cried during the pandemic, it's such a silly thing. But you know, everybody has something they love to do that they couldn't do during the pandemic. For me, it was Irish Fest. When they cancelled the Irish Fest, I cried. Because I was holding out the hope that I could have gotten home last year. And when they cancelled Irish Fest, that was my link to home. That's where I would have met all of my friends who are also homesick. And I had a few drinks, and danced too much, and laughed too much, and were generally silly for a whole week. Because Irish Fest is a week for us. And when it cancelled, I cried, because I realised all of us have grieved for something this year. It might be people. It might be events that have changed. It might have been for church. For the fact that your parish did not open for those months last year. It might be a thief of our certainty and what's familiar. And who likes wearing masks, right? Yeah. But we do it because we love each other. But all of us have lost someone this year. And I think this is the perfect time for us to really focus on home. And to focus on nourishing ourselves on Jesus Christ. We want to share some stories with each other. Before I do that, when you hear the word hope, what comes to mind? Now I know it's very difficult with your masks on to speak, but just raise your hand and then tell me, when you hear the word hope, what do you think about?
Never giving up.
Never giving up. Very good. What did you say?
Anticipate.
Something better.
Something better.
The future.
Yes.
Getting over an illness.
To feel peace.
To be at peace. These are all. Come on, this side of the room. This is really slipping.
Straight up, just Advent.
The waiting. Well, when we think about hope, I want us to really think about, I mean, this is a great image for us to relate, the well. To be people at the well, like the Samaritan woman comes because she's thirsty for living water. We are all thirsty right now for hope, for God's goodness, for mercy, for grace, for things to go back to the way we like them. But we know that life's changed. So I want to talk to you tonight about some things that changed for me during the pandemic. And I want to bring you to this place through this scripture. This is from Jeremiah. Blessed are those who trust in the Lord, whose trust is the Lord. I found this whose trust is in the Lord, but whose trust is God, whose trust is Jesus, which tells us something. Our hope is in God. Our hope is God, who is with us. In fact, I was with one of our senior priests this morning. He's a very, very wise, Father Jim Thiele. I don't know if any of you know him, but he's just such a lovely, loving man, so kind. And I said to him, I was kind of grouchy. You know when you get to this part of the year, like, the weather doesn't even know what he wants to do. I looked at him yesterday, and there was snowflakes, seriously, as big as my hand coming down. And last week, it was just like the spring was here, spring cleaning, pulling off our sheets away. I should know better. This isn't Wisconsin, right? But he said something to me. He said, never forget, Julia, no matter what we go through, God is always in the midst of us. God is always in the midst of us. So I want to take you back to a time in the history of the world where people had kind of given up a little bit of hope. Now, I want to share this. This is what's called a spiritual parallelism, meaning I'm drawing a comparison between two different time periods in history, but these things are not the same. So I'm not saying these things are equal in weight, but I want to draw some lessons from hope. So does anybody know what these leaves are on this tree? What kind of a tree? It's a, how do you know that? Master gardeners among us here? I've never seen this before. This is a gecko tree. And the gecko trees are 270 million years old. They're living fossils. They stretch all the way back to the Permian period. Right. Now, why are we talking about trees? You're going to say everything. The gecko trees are very, very famous in different parts of the world. And in fact, all the gecko trees that have cross-pollinated throughout the world came from a specific region in China. And Japan is known for having the most beautiful gecko trees. In fact, they're world famous. And the famous gecko trees of Hiroshima, after the A bombs dropped 75 years ago, went from being in full bloom like this to looking like this. Now, in a casualty in World War II, which took place 75 years ago, the bomb of Hiroshima was August 6th, 1945. The trees were overlooked as one more casualty of human destruction. So people were focusing on the human casualty and the human tragedy. And the trees were ignored. Now, you can see here, what do you notice about the trees? And it's all people have to shout out. It's amazing that they're standing and they're not vaporized, right? So they're still standing. Yeah. Right? I'm still standing. Trees are still standing. No leaves. Bark scorched. Roots completely ripped off. Nobody was more surprised than the Japanese when in the spring, at this time of the year, the gecko trees started budding out again. Somehow, 175 trees that they call to this day the A bomb trees survived Hiroshima. And you can see here the A bomb tree has grown to the roof of a temple in Hiroshima. Plants adapt, life adapts. In fact, there's a very, very famous tree in Ireland called the tree that eats the bench. A bench was pushed up against a tree, and the tree grew over, and literally it looks like the tree is eating the bench. It's a very, very famous tree in Dublin. But what does this teach us about faith and hope? The trees survived this kind of destruction. Leaves gone, bark sheared away, roots ripped off. Why? Because at the center of the tree was a cluster of living cells that communicated life to the rest of the tree. And the living cells sent up new life into the tree to communicate with the rest of the tree, like, hello, we are still here. Everything has changed on the outside, but on the inside, we're alive. And that's the same with you and I. bearers of hope, as bearers of faith. Each one of us stands on the shoulders of spiritual giants, of grandmothers, of fathers and mothers, friends, who've passed along the faith from one person to another for thousands of years. One of my favorite expressions is, the gospel has been gossiped from person to person and village to village all across the world. So I want to suggest that there are three things that I think we need to recover as disciples today for our church and our Lord. The deep roots that we have as a living community of faith are our rootedness in Jesus Christ. The bark that protects us is the church. It's the body of Christ, and it may feel right now, we're all the people. We're a community. We will survive this. We will grow strong. And then, leaves always adaptable. If you have one of those prayer plants, does anyone have a prayer plant in their house? You know the Maranatha plants? You have a master gardener over there, I think you are. She's all sorts of plants, and she's totally tracking along. The leaves change all day. They move toward the direction of the sun. In fact, I grow orchids. It's amazing because I kill spiderbugs. And peace lilies are misnamed. They never look peaceful to me. They're all droopy or I overwater them. But I can grow orchids, and I notice the orchids change and grow toward the light. When hope is present in our lives, we can grow toward that hope. And we will regenerate, we will adapt, we will flex to new challenges we've never seen before. Hope, healing, and hospitality are three things that our world really needs right now. We need the hope of Jesus Christ. We need the healing to really talk about what has this time been like for families? What has this been like for us personally? And then I'm not just talking about hospitality in terms of welcoming, like coffee or some of the social aftermath. That's great, but I'm talking about the hospitality that gives new life. The openness, the welcoming to new ideas, new ways of being, church, new ways of seeing ourselves while still keeping the beauty of our Catholic tradition in mind. Hope, healing, and hospitality. The famous ginkgo trees, the Japanese call the tree the bearer of hope. So when you look up the ginkgo tree, I'm often reminded by this scripture. Blessed are those who trust in the Lord, whose trust is in the Lord. They shall be like a tree planted by water, sending out its roots by the stream. We shall not fear when heat comes, and our leaves will stay green in the year of drought. We are not anxious, because we will not cease to bear fruit. Trees, if you think about our leaves, Our Lady, there she is. Notice that Our Lady, as she's holding up Jesus, she's presenting Jesus to us. She doesn't point to herself, she points to her son. And one of my favorite images of Jesus and Mary is this very, very, very rotund and round Mary. Like you can tell, she is very close to having baby Jesus. And which you can see through, and you can see Jesus dancing inside. Mary herself was the bearer of hope for the whole world. So Jesus and Mary stand as people of hope Friday. I do miss that. Going on holiday. But I want to share with you this story. This is a, I have to watch my time. I'm really bad at time. I only have an hour to check. It's 22 days. What is good? My son is in a class with four other children. This was actually a couple of years ago. And they had to come up with a project that they wanted to do. And I'm going to tell you this story because I think this is going to be more of an issue with our kids post-COVID and more of an issue with our elderly, which is loneliness. And the kids are trying to come up with some sort of service project to do in their local community. And they talked about like stitching quilts and like baking things and all kinds of things. But one of the girls in the class said, you know, I go to visit my nana at the nursing home. And I've noticed that there are some people that live at the nursing home that never get any visits. And isn't that terribly sad? And so, there's four kids in this class said, well, why don't we do something about it for our Destination Imagination project? And so they started what I would call a ministry. But they started pulling their heads together, and this group of kids said, well, what do they like to do in the nursing home that we could do with them? And one of the girls said, they really like to play bingo. Okay. But I noticed they get kind of grouchy when they run out of quarters. And they get a bingo, and they're playing for nothing. It doesn't seem as fun then, she said. So she said, why don't we raise some funds to play bingo? And we'll go into the nursing home at 3 o'clock after school, and we'll play bingo with them. And when they get a bingo, we'll give them a quarter, but we'll also give them a hug. So this is what these group now. You can see, so this is a very interesting story. I'm in the top corner on the right. I went in this day to see how they ran their bingo. So that's me, my little cup of tea, sitting beside this gentleman. And you can see, this is my son with his glasses. When the lady got her bingo, she was this little, nice, sweet little lady. Oh, she said. And she got her quarter and she came in for the hug. But there was one individual in the room who got quite grouchy with the kids when they were like, is that 69 or 6 or 96? When their numbers were mixed up, I said, call the numbers again. I was like, okay. I learned after this gentleman. And it was a veteran. So God only knows if he had some PTSD or what he'd seen in life. But he definitely spoke like he was a commander, right? And so you see some people nudging each other. I'm married to one of those. And I wonder what the kids would do when this gentleman called the bingo. And so this gentleman called the bingo. And here he is. And all four of those children went up. I, if this was me, I would be reluctant and quite nervous to give him a hug. But not one of them went up. They all went up. These children recognized that this man needed more love, not less. They never spoke to each other. They just all went in and they hugged him. And then he leaned back. And I'm right beside him, so I could hear this. He leaned back and he closed his eyes and said, I love it when they do that. I love it when they do that. I cried my eyes out on the way home. People are longing for connection and love and meaning. And I think what this pandemic has made us is touch hungry. To be hungry. Only filled with the hope and the love that other people face. So I wanted to share this story because to me it speaks of hope and joy in God's mercy and love. And also to be bold. You know, to be bold. Bishop Rickon often says this, it's a quote from a saint, where there is no love, chews very loudly at lunch. I said, how did you not know that? She said, well, he eats the same lunch every day, but he usually eats it at work. He crunches. He crunches his lunch. He has all his raw veggies during. I was like, way too much information. But I don't think it's tested all. I think the people we went in are not the people that came on the other side. And in some instances, that is a very, very good thing. It can feel in this swirling. So there's a very interesting name. It's from centrifugal force. It's what your washing machine uses to actually do. It moves things around and the dirt gets flung away. What if that is what's happening to us right now? Where we feel like we're losing control, but God is using to put us through this tilt-a-whirl of a pandemic. So all the icky things that we have clung on to are now being flung away. It can feel scary. And for some of us, instead of feeling refreshed, you feel tense, stressed, and you have negative energy and you have doubt. A self-care day isn't going to change this. Eating the largest tub of ice cream isn't going to change this. Renewal only comes from the Lord. You can be physically renewed. Like you can have rest, but if your mind is racing, your body will not be at peace, and neither will your spirit. And I think that's the hard thing about this pandemic, is it's preyed on our physical, mental, and spiritual health, and kind of come after all through. So this pandemic isn't just about keeping people safe and healthy. It's also about keeping us spiritually grounded and emotionally connected. So it's really causing us to reassess life. I wanted to share with you, we have a crisis of hope today. Between 1999 and 2017, among Americans between the ages of 25 and 64, the rate of drug overdose increased fourfold, rates of suicide increased 38%, midlife deaths from alcohol and liver disease grew by 40%, and alcohol poisoning rose fourfold. This is before the pandemic. Drinking, overdose, suicide, all of this. Researchers have termed these deaths, specifically these deaths, death by despair. Death by despair. These are, if you Google what are deaths by despair, these are the statistics that will come up. What's interesting is there was a global summit held about this crisis of despair at Harvard. And then you have sociologists, economists, you have financial activists, and all different kinds of people coming together to say, how can we change this? What is the one group of people that weren't there? Spiritual. And I'm not saying that the researchers want to do it, but people representing a spiritual conversation. Remember that slide I used? The further and further you move away from the core, the more out of control and scared you feel. What holds us together, the principle of integration in our lives, is our soul. Mind, body, spirit, your soul connects to you. And unless we address the root causes of despair, we'll never get to hope. Because hope isn't a happy feeling. It's not naive optimism. Hope is seeing and believing that there is more than what we see and experience today. I want to share this with you. This is a beautiful Irish poem. It's called The Old Healer to the Soul. It's not your back that hurts you, but it's the burden you carry. It's not your eyes that hurt, but the injustice that you see. It's not your head that hurts, but it's the thoughts that weigh you down. It's not your throat, but what you express or withhold or say with anger. It's not your stomach that hurts, but what your soul does not digest. It's not your liver that hurts, but it's the anger you carry inside. It's not your heart that hurts, but love. And it's love itself that contains the most powerful. Now, this is not to say that you can't have physical conditions. What I'm saying is, sometimes the underneath of what we carry is people say, oh, that person passed away peacefully or gracefully. That says something very different. We all carry different burdens with us, but we have to give those away. So I want to tell you about this king. I want to share this story with you, because this to me is a great example of not seeing God's will, in fact. Actually, I have two stories. Let's see if I can get Sean's story comes up. Let's give my Sean's story first, and then I'll go back. So this is my little fella, Sean Patrick. We call him Sean Patrick, but we used to call him Simple Chuck, because he was a very blonde baby. This is my husband, Wayne, and we have three children. I had a significant health scare a couple of years ago, in fact, 2 years ago, if I'm being precise, 2.5 years ago. And you have to know we have a family history of some very, very severe cancers in our family. And my mom passed away from cancer, her grandma passed away from very aggressive cancer, my grandmother had cancer, she had breast cancer to be specific. Cancer all across our family, in fact, we have genetics, a whole lot of amounts. One day I was walking on the beach in Alabama, where I walked to pick up sea glass, and I was bending down. I felt a wobble. Now, there's wobbles that you get when you have a certain age. This was not one of them. This was like, what was that? That was a pee, like a wobbly kind of a feeling. If you've ever had a little pee, you know what I'm talking about. Later on that day, I was doing a little investigation. I was like, I found a lump. What? Me? I found a lump? I definitely found a lump. I don't know what. Maybe it's just there. You know, you kind of go down that. And I kind of go out of my head. Not a good idea. A couple of days later, felt the lump again. I thought, you know what, I probably should say something. But I was afraid to say I found a lump, because I think verbalizing it felt very scary to me. So I was lying in bed and reached over to grab my husband's hand. I did not touch feet. I just did not touch his feet. His feet looking really fast. I went over and I just grabbed his hand. I see some of you, yeah, you're feeling like a nice box there. Grabbed his hand and I said, oh, I have to tell you, I found a lump, but I'm very scared. He said, Jeanette, not something to mess with. Let's get you to the doctor. So I went to the doctor the next day and she said, yeah, that's a lump. I can definitely feel it. It's not good. It's not good where it is. We need to get you in for a scan. Now, between that appointment and the scan was the longest days of my life. And then we did something that you should never do if you're feeling like you're low on hope. You Google your symptoms. And so I Googled my symptoms, and all of a sudden I'm picking out my casket in my head, and I'm thinking to myself, I can't go through this. Now, I was telling you, I'm a fearful person. I could find no peace because my head kept going to, I had three children, what's going to happen to them? You know, all the human things that I kept saying, God, please just take this pain from me. I just don't want to have to think about this every minute of the day because I was so nervous. My scan happened to be on my mother's anniversary. And I went in anyway and I was like, this is my mother's anniversary. Day of her death, the Lord just sent me signs, gave a picture of a butterfly in her office, which my mother loved, and it's inconclusive, Julianne. We have to go through this again. And I went on, I can't figure this out. I thought I was like doing a good job, appearing kind of happy during this time. But I think I had moments where that slipped naturally. And I was just very sad. And so I was tucking the baby into bed one night. He's not a baby anymore. And he was 5 actually at the time. And I said, Sean, I kissed him and talked to him. And he sat up in the bed. And he said, Ma'am, is it true? And I said, is what true? He goes, you know the man at church, the father? And I was like, oh gosh, who are we talking about now? Because you have to. I have a priest friend whose father is a cousin of mine, so fathers are always popping over. I'm on the phone with my father in Ireland, but then if I get a call from work about from father, all day. So this child was kind of confused. I said, what do you mean? Because you know the father. someone says to me, I gave my job, you never told us what happened to the loan. And I said, I still have the loan. Like, the loan is still there, just kind of hanging out, doing its own thing. And it just never went anywhere. And so I finally got the all clear on September 14th, 2020, which is the 8-year anniversary of my mother's death. Four. Universe. It might not look like the thing. For you, it might look like the thing you are holding on to because you are afraid to take it out and look at it and say, what happened, Lord? It's like that joke drawer we all have in our houses, unless you are a superhuman, right? That you shove all the stuff into, right? Paperclips, pencils, things that hold papers together, an old car charger. What else is in your drawers?
Sticky pads.
Sticky pads that you never use. What else?
Screws.
Screws! Pennies, right? Last of the bags. Hands up, everyone who has a junk drawer in their house. Some of us have garages where we stuff all the junk we don't want to deal with in our house. Basements can become rooms of junk, and storage units can become the place where we hide junk. I think during this time, God is saying to us, is open the junk drawer of your heart and let me. Open up the thing that you've most kept and hidden away. The thing you're not proud of, the thing that you regret, and pull it out and let God's light and hope change. I can now look at this thing and I can smile. See, I think we think hope is about furry, furry little fluffy clouds and unicorns and babies and smells, and that's true. But hope is also at the intersection of our deepest pain. And where do we see that for us as Catholics? We see it on the cross. Hope came after Jesus had been completely, utterly broken down. The dawn of hope came when he opened himself up completely and emptied himself out and said, here I am. I abandon myself to you. That's what true hope looks like. Hope in society looks like hope floats and cute movies with Sandra Bullock and all. You're not going to get in trouble with my wife doing for saying that. And those are great. But we as people of faith are grounded in a hope that endures. I remember Sister Helen Prejean. Do you remember Dead Man Walking, that movie? About the sister who used to minister on death row to the inmates. And she told this story about hope, and I've never forgotten it. When she started off her ministry, she went to visit a man who committed an absolutely heinous crime. And she went and she sat with the victims, the family of the people that had been murdered that morning, and she prayed with them. And then that afternoon, she went and she visited the man who had murdered those children. And she came back to her community, and she came back to the sister, and the sister said to her, how can you do that in the same day? How can you sit with people who are in such despair, and this monster? And she said, you know what? I asked myself the same question. When I sit at the foot of the cross, and those arms are outstretched, you know who they're outstretched for? The hopeful and the hopeless. The murderer and the murdered. The person who's done right and the person who's done wrong. God's mercy and his arms are stretched out wide open for every single person. That's what hope looks like. That's what God looks like. And that's what we're called to. When I think of the word hope, I want to turn a lot of attitude. H-O-P-E. The thing. Hope heals. H. Heals hearts. The next word in H-O-P-E is O. Hope opens us up to seeing things we've never seen before. P. For prayer and presence. Hope is about being centered in the presence of each other, in the Lord God, and in Jesus' sacrifice. And the last E is Eucharist, which means thanksgiving. Because all have a right to live. So we can be there anyhow, because we have hope of the resurrection. Never lose hope. Continue to believe. Always find your way. Open up new horizons. Make us capable of dreaming what is not even imaginable. Hope always calls out to see beyond what we see. And I hope that this night, this coming together for you, has helped you look at hope in a different way. We are all wounded people. This is from Henry Nouwen, whether physically, emotionally, mentally, or spiritually. The main question is not how can we hide our wounds so we don't have to be embarrassed, but how can we put our wounds at the service of others? When our wounds cease to be a source of shame and become a source of healing, we have become wounded healers. And Jesus teaches us this. Because when Jesus came with the hope of the resurrection, he didn't come all like looking fabulous, like no wounds. When Jesus came after the resurrection, he came with his wounds visible, which tells you when you've had a resurrection experience in your life, you don't leave those wounds behind. I don't leave the thing behind either. I carry the thing with me every day and how I dealt with it and how I refuse to deal with it. That's why I'm grateful for the pandemic, because it made me look at my wounds differently. But Jesus also comes to us and says, let me touch the wounds. He lets Thomas push into that wound. And I think sometimes as Catholics, we think we have to be perfect and have everything in order. And you know what? God says, come to me anyway. I want to bless the mess of your life. So go forward, be bold. This is one of my favorite quotes from Pope Francis. The Spirit grants us the courage to proclaim the newness of the gospel, to see with fresh eyes. Let us call upon him today, firmly rooted in prayer. For without prayer, all our activity risks being fruitless and our message empty. Be bearers of hope, like the famous ginkgo trees of Hiroshima. They're still growing. They're still pollinating all over the world. They teach us we are strong, our roots are deep.
Yeah, a couple of people are watching.
In Irish, in Irish. started a whole journey with St. Patrick. And so I love reading about his writings. There's so many good books about his life. I love his original Confessions by F. Skinner. That's a really good translation of his work. And then there's this, you can do a retreat with St. Patrick. That's the name of the book. It's a great book. But after I married my husband, and we were in bed, my husband was a police officer. And so he was a deputy sheriff, to be very specific. And so, you know, they learned special language in police school, I guess. Like, are you the owner of this vehicle, man? That kind of language. And, like, he can give you a look. Like, you know, there's a Lemmy look, like an Irish Lemmy look, because he's a bit wild. Or just a regular Lemmy look, you know. But my husband can give you a look, and it's like, I am going to be arrested. And I remember waking up one morning, and he's the most gentle-minded fellow you'd ever meet. And he was leaning in, and I was getting the look. Good morning, hello. And he's like, we are going to pass talk. And I was like, what's wrong? He goes, I need to know something. And I want you to be very honest with me. None of this all Irish flowery now. I said, all right. He goes, who's Pat? And what is your relationship with him? Pat, are you talking about? I talk in my sleep. Like, if I am ever captured or interrogated by any agency for anything, all they have to do is put me to sleep, and apparently I just spill my guts in my sleep. He goes all night, Patrick this, and apparently I talk to St. Patrick in my sleep all the time. And so I just, oh, that's all St. Patrick. He goes, I guess it's a level of weirdness. He goes, I've never met anyone that talked to St. Patrick like he was in the room with them. And he is at St. Patrick. I feel his presence with me. And actually, I have a relative of St. Patrick. I was in Irish Fest. Do I have time for a Patrick? I was at Irish Fest a couple years ago, and I teach in the Irish Fest tent, like a cultural tent. And they gave me probably the worst time slot to do a talk. It's the 8 o'clock on Saturday night, which is people have been drinking all day, and they wander into your tent like, oh, you're Irish, you're smart. And you can see anything. I'm up there, and I'm talking about St. Patrick. And in wanders, you know, Mr. Joe Schmo from Kokomo, after having many beers, and says to me, well, how do we know St. Patrick actually lived, was a real person? I was like, great question, Joe Schmo from Kokomo. We know because we have two sources of his writings. The letter to King Corot, yeah, but you're anyone from the river. And I was like, well, we actually have fragments of his life. We got a part of his bell. And somebody said, I have a piece of his body. And I thought, this is getting very weird. And I said, no, it's good, let's go. And the other questions really prayed. Somebody else had a normal question and kind of got off topic. Afterwards, this couple came up to me, Patrick and Patricia Village from Milwaukee, and they said, if you have to wonder if St. Patrick is real, we have a piece of his bone. And I said, what? She said, oh yeah, we have a relic of St. Patrick. And we have the papers and everything to go along with it from our Vatican. And she said, we couldn't think of anyone we'd love to have more. So they gave me their relic about 8 years ago. So sometimes I do travel with St. Patrick, and when I get the question about is he real, would you like to see a piece of St. Patrick bone? Because that's just a whole very strange thing, right? But it helps me have conversations. So he's part of my life. For my birthday about 5 years ago, my husband found the most gorgeous stained glass window. Do you want to see it? Would you like to see the window? And then I promise I'll stop talking. I did this at a presentation the other day, and there's a window in my house. I found a church up in Elko had a remodel, and they pulled this window out of their church. And it's 140 years old, and it is very large and it's very raw. And so we have set into a wall of ours. So I now have very I just love him. And he's got so many lessons for us. His courage, his bravery, everything. I forgot, I had a little video for those that wanted to see it. Do you want to end with a little Irish blessing? Do you have time? Okay. during the pandemic, over 300 churches came together and recorded Beat Down Religion, which is the words of a hymn attributed to St. Patrick. And there's a very, very special prayer associated with Patrick called the Lorica. And the Lorica is a breastplate prayer. It literally, like when I have a tough day going, I literally imagine strapping on the armor of St. Patrick over me. And it comes from Ephesians, the armor of our faith. And St. better note to end than wishing you all an absolutely fantastic, you can say, rest of Lent. But as a journey toward Easter, I hope this was an opportunity for you to really recover a sense of hope in your